In this tutorial, you'll discover what happens when you mix derivatives and integrals. In other words, you'll be taking derivatives of integrals and integrals of derivatives. Whenever you take derivatives of integrals or vice versa, your strategy should be to use the fundamental theorem of calculus. First, let's look at derivatives of integrals. Now suppose big F is an antiderivative of little f. Then what does the fundamental theorem of calculus say is an equivalent expression for the integral of little f from a to b?
The fundamental theorem of calculus tells us that the integral of a function from a to b is equal to the antiderivative of that function, in this case it's big f, evaluated at the endpoints. So it's big f of b minus big f of a.
Right, the integral of little f from a to b equals big f of b minus big f of a. Now it doesn't matter what letter we use inside this integral. If we replace the x with a u, we're still integrating this function f from a to b. So this represents the same integral. But now let's set b equal to x. And that means we need to replace this b with an x as well. And now let's take the derivative of this integral. This looks like a really tricky expression to evaluate. So instead, try evaluating the right side of this expression.
We're trying to find the derivative of this expression here. And to do that, we're going to take the derivative of this side here. The derivative of f of x, right this way. And from that, we want to subtract the derivative of f of a. Now remember that f of a is just a number, like 3 or 4, something like 4. And the derivative of a constant is always 0, so this is just 0. We're left with the derivative of big f of x. What's another way to write that?
Excellent work. Let's quickly see how you got that. To find the derivative of this difference, you can find the derivative of the first part and subtract the derivative of the second part. We said big F is an antiderivative of little f. In other words, the derivative of big F is little f. So this expression here, the derivative of big F of x, is equal to little f of x. And this term is the derivative with respect to x of big F of a. A is just a number, a constant. So big F of A is another constant. It doesn't change as x changes, so this derivative is 0. Let's get rid of it. And so you found that the derivative of this integral gives you back F of X. Now let's make this expression a little crazier. What if instead of an X up here, we make this an X squared? What's the derivative of this integral? Hint, try using the fundamental theorem of calculus again, and then also use the chain rule.
Let's pretend the antiderivative of little f is big f. So this expression becomes the derivative with respect to x of big f evaluated at the top endpoint minus big f evaluated at the bottom endpoint. Now big f of a is just a constant number, so its derivative is going to be 0. We simplify this, you just get the derivative of big F of x squared. Try evaluating that using the chain rule and this expression here. So far we've said that this derivative of an integral over here is equal to the derivative of f of x squared. What's that? Well, we can use the chain rule. This is equal to the derivative of f evaluated at x squared, times the derivative of the thing inside the parentheses, times 2x. Now we know that f prime of x is equal to little f, so we can write this as little f of x squared, times 2x. And that's our answer.
done. First, using the fundamental theorem of calculus, you found that this integral equals big F of x squared minus big F of a. Then you split this up into two derivatives. A is a constant number, and so big F of a is another constant number. Its derivative is zero. Then you focused on finding the derivative of big F of x squared, and here's where you used the chain rule. First, the derivative of the outer function, big F, is little f, giving us little f of x squared. The inner function is x squared, and the derivative of x squared is 2x. This looks a little nicer if we put the 2x in front. Great, so the derivative of this integral from a to x squared is 2x times f of x squared. You're really good at finding these derivatives of integrals, but now let's switch things up again. What if we make the x squared the lower limit of the integral, and we make the a the upper limit? What's the derivative of this integral?
The first thing we want to do is use the fundamental theorem of calculus to write this as the derivative of big F of a minus big F of x squared. Try taking this derivative, and again, remember that big F of a is just the number. So far, we've said that this integral is equal to big F of a minus big F of x squared. What's the derivative of that? Well, the derivative of big F of a is just zero, because a is just the number. That goes to zero. And then when we take the derivative of big F of x squared, we have to use the chain rule. The minus sign comes out. The derivative of big F is little f, minus little f of x squared. And then the chain rule tells us that we have to multiply that by 2 times x. And that's our answer.
Exactly. You could have used the fundamental theorem of calculus, or you could have used an integral identity and switched the limits of this integral and included a minus sign. Either way, you get the same answer of minus 2x times f of x squared. Now let's try a problem where both the upper and lower limits of the integral depend on x. Here we have the integral of the cosine function from x to x squared. What's the derivative with respect to x of this integral?
You may remember that the antiderivative of cosine is sine, but you don't need to use that to solve this problem. Let's just call the antiderivative of cosine big F. So f prime of x is going to be the cosine of x. Then this integral is equal to big F evaluated at the top endpoint minus big F evaluated at the bottom endpoint. What's that? Well, why don't you try evaluating it using the chain rule to see if you can figure out the answer. So far, we've said that the derivative of this integral is equal to the derivative of big F evaluated at x squared minus big F evaluated at x. To evaluate those derivatives, we need to use the chain rule. Let's give it a shot. So this is the derivative of big F at x squared, so that's f prime at x squared. And then we have to use the chain rule to take the derivative of the thing inside parentheses, so it's times 2x. From that we have to subtract big F prime evaluated at x, and the derivative of this thing is just 1, so there's no chain rule. Finally, we know that f prime of x is just the cosine of x. So this is the cosine of x squared times 2x minus the cosine of x. And that's the answer.
Once again, you can use the fundamental theorem of calculus. If big F is an antiderivative of cosine, then this integral equals big F of x squared minus big F of x. The sine of x is one such antiderivative, but you don't really need to know that for this problem, because when you take the derivatives of these two expressions, you go back to having cosines. Using the chain rule, you found that the derivative of big F of x squared is 2x times cosine x squared. Now we're subtracting the derivative of big F of x, which is cosine x again. Great. Now let's look at the generic derivative of an integral. Suppose you want to find the derivative with respect to x of the integral of a function f, where the integral goes from g to h, where g and h are both functions that depend on x. Can you find an equivalent expression for the derivative of this integral?
To begin with, let's just assume we have an antiderivative of little f of x that's called big f. If that's the case, then this integral down here is equal to big f evaluated at the top endpoint, that's h, minus big f evaluated at the bottom endpoint, that's g. Remember that h and g both depend on x. Why don't you try taking the derivatives using the chain rule and this rule here? So we have to take the derivative of big F of h minus big F of g. If you use the chain rule, that's equal to f prime of h times dh dx, or h prime of x, minus f prime of g times g prime of x. Now finally, we don't want to write our answer with big F. We actually want to write it in terms of little f. But little f is just the derivative of big F. So this is little f of h times h prime of x minus little f of g times g prime of x. And remember that this h here and this g here both depend on x. They're functions of x. And that's the answer.
Nicely done. Yes, this expression is equivalent to f of h times h prime of x minus f of g times g prime of x. This formula is probably not worth memorizing. If you ever encounter the derivative of an integral, like this one, you can always work it out using the fundamental theorem of calculus and the chain rule, which is basically what this formula says. So that is derivatives of integrals. Let's look at integrals of derivatives. Let's go back to the fundamental theorem of calculus. The little f inside this integral we said is equal to the derivative of big F. So let's replace the little f here with a big F prime. And notice that we're now taking the integral of a derivative. Let's try out one more problem. Try using this formula for finding integrals of derivatives to evaluate this expression. It's the integral with respect to x, and from u to v, of the derivative of the tangent of x.
We're trying to take the integral of this thing here, so let's call that little f. The first step to taking an integral is to find an antiderivative of little f. In this case, we're looking for a function so that f prime of x is equal to little f, which is the derivative of the tangent. Well, the tangent function works really well here. If big F of x is equal to the tangent of x, we're all set. Now that we know big F of x, we can just use the fundamental theorem of calculus. Why don't you give it a shot? So far, we've identified the antiderivative of the integrand. It's just the tangent of x. So now we can use the fundamental theorem to evaluate this integral. It's the antiderivative evaluated at the upper endpoint minus the antiderivative evaluated at the lower endpoint. Well, we know the antiderivative is just the tangent of x, so we have the tangent of v minus the tangent of u, and that's our answer.
In this tutorial, you'll figure out a few more rules for integrals. First, let's review some of the rules you've already discovered. If you add the integral of a function from a to b to the integral of the same function from b to c, what does this sum equal?
Let's see what each of these pieces looks like on a graph. If we have some function f of x, then this first piece, the integral from a to b, is the area under the curve between two points. Say this is a, and this is b. That first integral is this area here. The second integral, from b to c, is the area under the curve between b and c. So it's that area there. Which of the expressions in the answer choices is another way to write the area of this curve all the way from a to c?
Yes, the sum of the integrals from a to b and b to c is the integral from a to c. Let's see if you remember another integral identity. Suppose you switch the upper and lower limits of an integral. What's an equivalent expression for this integral here?
If you have an integral that starts at 2 and ends at 5, it's always going to be equal to minus the same integral starting at 5 and ending at 2. Try generalizing that rule to get the answer.
Exactly. Switching the upper and lower limits is equivalent to multiplying the integral by minus 1. Okay, now suppose you want to find the integral of the sum of two functions. For example, let's say you want to find the integral of f of x plus g of x from a to b. How can we simplify this integral? Here are sample functions for f and g. The integrals of f and g are the areas under the curves. Now remember that we can think of a function as being like the heights of lots of really, really thin bars, and the integral of the function is the combined area of these bars. Here are very thin bars that represent the function f, and here are thin bars that represent the function g. Try thinking about these bars, and see if you can come up with an equivalent way to write the integral of f of x plus g of x.
When we add two functions together, it's like taking these bars, corresponding to g, and stacking them over here. So we'd end up with a graph that looks sort of like this, which would correspond to f plus g. And the integral, or the area under f plus g between b and a, would correspond to this area here. It includes the area here, under f, plus this area over here, which is the area under g. Which expression on the left corresponds to the area under f plus the area under g?
Nicely done. Let's see how you got that. Let's put the functions f and g onto the same graph. Adding the functions together is like stacking one function on top of the other, which is also like stacking the bars on top of each other. So here we've stacked the blue bars, which have the heights of the function f, on top of the purple bars, which have the heights of the function g. The combined heights of the bars give this black curve here, which is the function f of x plus g of x. And the combined areas of all these bars represent the integral of f of x plus g of x, or the area under the black curve. In other words, for any functions f and g, to find the integral of f plus g, you can take the integrals of f and g and add them together. This rule also works if you replace these two plus signs with minus signs. Great. So that's another integral identity. Let's see if we can find yet another one. Consider the integral of a times f of x, where a is a constant number, like minus 1, 17.4, or a third. Actually, let's look at the example when a is a third. And let's draw a function f of x. The integral of f of x is approximated by the area of these very thin bars. If we draw another set of green bars that are each a third the height of their corresponding blue bars, then we have the integral of this green curve here, which is the function 1/3 times f of x. So what do you think is an equivalent expression for this integral of 1/3 times f of x over here?
The area of all the green bars is equal to 1/3 the area of all the blue bars. And the area of the blue bars can be written as an integral from a to b of f of x dx.
Exactly right. The integral of 1/3 times f of x equals the integral of f of x times 1/3. In other words, we can pull the constant, which is 1/3 in this example, out of the integral without changing the value of this expression. And this equation works for any value of the constant, and not just the number 1/3. So let's replace the 1/3 with a, which can represent any constant. Now let's put these identities to work with a few examples. Try using these integral identities, and any others you may remember, to simplify this integral, the integral from 7 to 3 of f of x minus 2 g of x.
We're trying to find the integral of f minus 2g. Using this rule up here, we can rewrite that as the integral of f minus the integral of 2g. And again, they're all going to go from 7 to 3. Now if we use the second rule, we can rewrite the second integral as 2 times the integral of g. Now notice all the answer choices go from 3 to 7, and what we've written down goes from 7 to 3. Why don't you try using another integral rule to switch the boundaries for each of those integrals?
Nicely done. Let's quickly review how you got that. You can perform these simplification steps in a different order, but here's one way to do it. First, you can break up this integral into two separate integrals, both over the same range from 7 to 3. So that's the integral of f of x from 7 to 3 minus the integral of 2g of x from 7 to 3. Usually, the upper limit of the integral will be the bigger number. So let's flip the upper and lower limits for both these integrals, remembering that we have to multiply each integral by minus 1 when we do this. Otherwise, we'd be changing the value of these expressions. And now we can use this identity, which says we can pull constants out of integrals when they're being multiplied by everything else inside the integral. So let's pull this 2 out. And here's the simplified expression we found for this integral over here. Okay, last question. Evaluate this expression. It's the integral from minus 2 to 3 of cosine x over 2 minus 3x to the 4th. These identities can help you out.
To evaluate this integral, we first find the antiderivative, big F, and then evaluate it at the upper boundary, minus big F, evaluated at the lower boundary. What's the antiderivative of our integrand? Well, the antiderivative of cosine is sine. So that first term is going to give us sine of x over 2. And to take the integral of a power, we increase the power by 1. So this is minus 3, x to a higher power, x to the 5th. And then we divide by that higher power to take care of what happens when we take the derivative. Try using this expression for capital F to find the answer. So we've said that the antiderivative of the function is sine of x over 2 minus 3/5 x to the 5th, and the integral is that antiderivative evaluated at 3 minus that antiderivative evaluated at minus 2. Let's first evaluate it at 3. That's the sine of 3 over 2 minus 3/5 times x, which is 3 to the 5th. Which is minus 145.73. This is minus 145.73. Now let's evaluate it at minus 2. So that's sine minus 2 divided by 2 minus 3/5 times minus 2 to the 5th. That's 18.75. That's 18.75. And then we want to subtract it because of this minus sign here. And when we combine them, we get minus 145.73 minus 18.75, which equals minus 164.48. It's minus 164.48.
Here you'll learn about a trick called integration by substitution that can help you evaluate some integrals. Let's start off with a function, 2x times the cosine of x squared. Suppose you're asked to find the integral of this function. What's its antiderivative?
We're just going to have to guess and check. Let's start by focusing on this cosine here. What's the antiderivative of cosine? Well, it's sine. But if you just say the answer is the sine of x, and you take a derivative, you'll just get the cosine of x. It's not quite what we want. We want the cosine of x squared. How do we get that? Well, we could have put an x squared over here. So if we start with the sine of x squared, what do we get? Well, the derivative of sine of x squared is the cosine of x squared, and the chain rule tells us we have to multiply that by 2x. Fortunately, we have a 2x here and a cosine of x squared over here, so this is a perfectly good antiderivative of the integrand here. Note that if we did have that 2x here, we'd be in a lot of trouble.
Exactly. One antiderivative is the sine of x squared. You could also have added a constant over here. So if you take the derivative of the sine of x squared, you need to use the chain rule. The derivative of the x squared inside the sine function is 2x, and the derivative of the sine function is cosine. So the derivative of sine of x squared is 2x cosine x squared, just as you found. You are able to find this integral because of the chain rule partners here. The x squared inside the cosine function here has a derivative of 2x, which showed up out here and was being multiplied by the cosine x squared. If that 2x wasn't there, then this integral would have been incredibly difficult. Let's look at another integral that you can check using the chain rule. Suppose you want to find the integral of cosine x times e to the sine x. And let's make this a definite integral, meaning the integral between two specific points, from x equals 0 to x equals 1. Whenever you're integrating a function that looks like it was created by the chain rule, one way to help you evaluate that integral is called the substitution method. Here's how it works. The sine x inside the exponential function has a chain rule partner out here, the cosine x. Let's define a new variable, u, as being equal to sine x. How can you rewrite the expression cosine x times e to the sine x in terms of this new variable u?
Getting rid of the sine of x is easy. That's just u. What about this cosine of x? Try taking a derivative of this expression to get rid of the cosine of x. We know that sine of x is equal to u, and if you take the derivative of that expression, you get the cosine of x. So everywhere we see cosine of x, we can just write du dx. And where we see the sign of x, we can just write u. And that's how we translate the original expression into one that involves u's.
Right. Cosine x equals du dx, and e to the sine x equals e to the u. Next, let's make another copy of this integral. And let's plug in our new expression that's in terms of u into this copy of the integral over here. Well, let's just swap the order of the du dx and e to the u terms here. And remember that the du and dx terms represent very small changes in u and x respectively. They're not just symbols, they represent very tiny numbers. So we can cancel out the dx in the denominator here with this dx. And that leaves us with an integral with respect to u. And this integral looks a lot friendlier than our original integral. But there's one small problem here, the limits of integration. Our original integral had limits that went from 0 to 1, meaning it's the integral from x equals 0 to x equals 1. In our new integral over here, which is respect to u, we're still taking the integral from x equals 0 to x equals 1. To evaluate this integral, we'll have to change these limits so that they're from one value of u to another value of u. But let's start with the upper limit. When x equals 1, what's the equivalent limit for u?
If x is equal to 1 and u is equal to the sine of x, that means that u is going to be the sine of 1. So that's our new upper limit for u.
Exactly. When x equals 1, that means u equals the sine of 1, which is about 0.84. What should the lower limit of this integral be?
If x is equal to 0, that means u is going to be the sine of 0. So u is the sine of 0, and the sine of 0 is still 0. So the lower limit stays 0.
Zero, and sine 0 equals 0. So now this integral is all set. It's the integral with respect to u of e to the u from u equals 0 to the sine of 1, or about 0.84. Try evaluating this integral.
This is a definite integral, so we can evaluate it using the fundamental theorem of calculus. The answer is going to be the antiderivative evaluated at 0.84, or the sine of 1, minus the antiderivative evaluated at 0. To evaluate this, we need to find an antiderivative of the integrand. That is, we need to find a function f whose derivative is equal to e to the u. Why don't you try to figure out what that big f is and use it to find the answer? To evaluate this integral using the fundamental theorem of calculus, we first need to find an antiderivative of e to the u. You may remember that the derivative of e to the x is e to the x. So one antiderivative of e to the u is just e to the u. So what's your answer? Well, it's f of 0.84, or e to the 0.84, minus e to the 0. E to the 0 is 1. So this is equal to e to the 0.84, which is about 2.32. This is 2.32 minus 1, or 1.32.
Good work. Let's try another example. The integral of the natural log of x squared divided by x from x equals 2 to x equals 5. But before you attempt this, let's quickly jot down the steps you took to evaluate that last integral. First, you found an expression inside the integral that's multiplied by its derivative. Then you set that expression equal to u. The dx in du dx canceled out the dx in the integral. And then you had to adjust the limits of integration. So let's try these steps out on this integral here. But first, you'll need to find an expression inside this integral that's being multiplied by its derivative. Which expression should u be setting equal to u?
This ln of x here is pretty intimidating, but remember that the derivative of ln of x is equal to 1 over x. If that's true, what's a good choice of u in this equation? If we rewrite this integral, 2 to 5, 1 over x, times ln of x squared, this 1 over x is a great chain rule piece for this ln of x because the derivative of the natural log is 1 over x. So a great choice for u here is the ln of x because its chain rule piece is sitting out in front.
Precisely. As you suggested, let's set u equal to the natural log of x. At this point, try following these remaining steps to rewrite this integral in terms of u, and then evaluate the integral.
Let's start by setting all these natural logs to u's. So our integral is going to be the integral from x equals 2 to x equals 5 of u squared over x times dx. Now we still have to get rid of x's here, 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 and up here. How do you do that? Well, you have to take the derivative of u with respect to x. Why don't you give that a shot and see if you can get rid of some of those x's? So far, we've replaced the natural logs with u's, but we still have this 1 over x dx to get rid of. To do that, let's try taking the derivative of u with respect to x. What's du dx? Well, if u is the natural log of x, du dx is 1 over x. So let's try replacing this 1 over x by du dx. These dx's will cancel, and we're left with the integral from x equals 2 to x equals 5 of u squared times du. Now, we're not quite there yet. We still want to get rid of those x's here and here. How do we do that? So far, we've converted everything inside this integral to u's, but we still have an x equals 2 and an x equals 5 as the boundaries of the integral. How can we get rid of those? Well, we can use this expression here that lets us convert x's into u's. So if x equals 2, that means u, which is the ln of x, is going to be the natural log of 2. So that's going to be our lower boundary. And our upper boundary is going to be the natural log of 5. So our integral now looks like the integral from u equals the natural log of 2 to u equals the natural log of 5 of u squared du. Why don't you try evaluating that using the fundamental theorem of calculus? Great. Now we have an integral that's all in terms of u. To evaluate it, we can use the fundamental theorem of calculus. The first thing we want to do is find an antiderivative of u squared. In this case, 1 third u cubed will do the trick. And then we want to evaluate it at u equals the natural log of 2, and also at u equals the natural log of 5, and then subtract. So our answer will be 1 third times the natural log of 5 cubed minus 1 third times the natural log of 2 cubed. Let's use our calculator for that. So 1/3 times the natural log of 5 cubed minus 1/3 times the natural log of 2 cubed is equal to 1.279. 1.279. And that's your answer.
Nice work. Well, let's quickly recap what you did. First, you noted that the function inside this integral can be rewritten as the natural log square of x times 1 over x. Since u equals the natural log of x, the natural log squared of x equals u squared. And you remembered that 1 over x is the derivative of the natural log of x. So you rewrote this 1 over x term as du dx. Step 3 here says to cancel the dx in this derivative with the dx of the integral. And that left you with the integral of u squared from x equals 2 to x equals 5. Step 4 was to rewrite these limits of integration in terms of u. Going from x equals 2 to x equals 5 is the same thing as going from u equals the natural log of 2 to u equals the natural log of 5. Finally, you evaluated this similar looking integral. The antiderivative of u squared is u cubed over 3. So to evaluate this definite integral, you plug the upper limit into this expression, giving you the natural log of 5 cubed over 3. And then you subtract it from that, the antiderivative evaluated at the lower limit of the natural log of 2. That gave you the correct answer of about 1.28. Okay, so this strategy called integration by substitution, and sometimes known as u substitution because the letter u is commonly used for this, it can help you evaluate integrals when you suspect the function inside the integral was created using the chain rule of another function. In other words, try out this substitution method when you see an expression that's being multiplied by its derivative, even if that expression is inside another function. For example, here you set u equal to the natural log of x, which was being squared, but was then multiplied by 1 over x, the derivative of the natural log. As a final challenge, take a look at these four integrals here. Don't worry, you don't have to evaluate them. Which of these integrals can be simplified by u substitution? Maybe you can tell just by looking at all the functions, but a good strategy would be to find a function inside the integral whose derivative also appears inside the integral, and to set that function equal to u and see if you can get the dx's to cancel like step 3 suggests.
This first integrand looks like it may have come from using the chain rule. For example, if we had the sine of u to the x, the chain rule would have put this e to the x up front, multiplying the whole expression. The second integrand does not look like it could have come from using the chain rule, because with the chain rule you always end up multiplying by a derivative. So this e to the x, for example, would have created an e to the x multiplying the cosine, like it did over here, not being added to it. So that's no good. That's pretty good. Why don't you try looking at these two to figure out which one could have come from using the chain rule? So far, we've said that this would work well with a u substitution because this e to the x is a chain rule piece for this e to the x. Here, the e to the x is being added instead of multiplied, which is not what you get from the chain rule, so this is no good. Down here, it looks like this cosine of x could be a chain rule piece for the sine, but if you try to take the derivative of sine of e to the x, you're always going to get a cosine of e to the x, not a cosine of x. So this actually wouldn't come from the chain rule, and it's no good. Finally, let's take a look at this one. This cosine of x could have been the derivative of this sine of x. So a u substitution here would work quite well. And those are the answers.
Here you'll learn yet another trick called trig substitution that can help you evaluate integrals for certain kinds of functions. Well, let's start with the function 1 over the square root of 1 minus x squared. Let's find the indefinite integral, meaning the antiderivative, of this function. In an earlier tutorial, you learned about the u substitution method. By setting u equal to a function of x when the derivative of that function also showed up in the integral, you could transform a messier integral into a simpler one. What would be a good function for u substitution in this integral?
It would be nice if this was just 1 over the square root of x instead of 1 over the square root of some complicated expression. To clean it up, we could say u equals 1 minus x squared. But then du dx, the derivative of u, would be minus 2x. And this doesn't appear anywhere up there. In fact, you could try some of the other choices for u, and you'll still find that the chain rule piece doesn't appear anywhere in the integral. So none of these are good u substitutions.
Right. None of those choices made the integral easier to solve. So instead of a u substitution, we'll use what's called a trig substitution to help us evaluate this integral. Instead of defining u as some function of x, we'll instead define x as a function of another variable, which we'll call theta. Let's specifically set x equal to the sine of theta. If we set x equal to sine theta, then what's an equivalent way to write dx? As always, ask for a hint if you get stuck.
Let's try to take the derivative of this expression with respect to theta. d theta. On the left, we'll get dx d theta. And on the right, we'll just get the cosine of theta. Now you can move the d theta to the other side to get the answer.
Nicely done. Right, if x equals sine theta, then dx d theta equals cosine theta. Multiplying both sides by d theta reveals that dx equals cosine theta times d theta. Okay, so now that we have new expressions for x and dx, substitute these into the integral. Hopefully they make the integral a little prettier.
We can use this expression to substitute for x, and this one to substitute for dx. When we do that, we get the integral of 1 over the square root of 1 minus sine squared theta times the cosine of theta times d theta. Try using a trig identity to simplify this, and then see if you can figure out the answer. This expression here, 1 minus sine squared of theta, is equal to the cosine squared of theta. And when we take the square root of that, we're just going to get the cosine of theta. We also have the cosine of theta up here in the numerator, so this simplifies to just the integral of d theta.
Exactly. First, you replaced the dx with cosine theta d theta. Then you substituted sine theta for x inside the square root. That gave you the square root of 1 minus sine squared theta. Using the trig identity that sine squared plus cosine squared equals 1, you found that this expression is equal to cosine theta. That made the integral 1 over cosine theta times cosine theta d theta. Let's move this cosine theta term into the numerator of the fraction. The cosine theta terms cancel out, leaving us with the integral of 1 d theta. When you're taking the integral of 1, you'll usually see the 1 left out. In this case, we can write this integral as the integral of d theta. But again, you can also think of this as being the integral of the function 1. Now evaluate this indefinite integral.
The integral of d theta is just the integral of 1 times d theta. What's an antiderivative of 1? That is, what function has a derivative equal to 1? Well, it's a linear function. So the answer is theta plus a constant, because the derivative of any constant is 0.
Right. The integral of d theta is theta. And you can also add a constant c here. But our original integral was in terms of x, so we'd like our final result to be in terms of x as well. Can you rewrite this expression here in terms of x?
The only angles we have to worry about in this problem are between negative pi over 2 and pi over 2. So we can rewrite this as theta equals the inverse sine of x.
Exactly. If you take the inverse sine of both sides of this expression here, the inverse sine and sine functions on the right side cancel out, leaving us with theta equals the inverse sine of x. So this integral equals the inverse sine of x plus c. Let's see the original integral again. So by using trig substitution, you found that the integral of 1 over the square root of 1 minus x squared is equal to the inverse sine of x plus c. Sure enough, if you look back to see what the derivative of the inverse sine of x is, it's 1 over the square root of 1 minus x squared. The general strategy for trig substitution is to try it for integrals in which 1 plus or minus x squared shows up. You can set x equal to trig functions like sine, tangent, and secant, which is 1 over the cosine. And remember to use the expression for dx d theta to find an expression for dx in terms of theta and d theta. One last problem. Try using trig substitution to evaluate this integral, the integral of 1 over 1 plus x squared.
You can try all of these possible trig substitutions, but the one that'll work best here is x equals the tangent of theta. Try using that one to get an answer. If x is equal to the tangent of theta, that means dx d theta is equal to the secant squared of theta. And we can move this theta over to the other side to get that dx is equal to the secant squared of theta times d theta. Try putting those substitutions in to simplify the integral. If we take these expressions for x and dx and plug them into this integral, we're left with the integral of 1 over 1 plus tangent squared of theta times the secant squared of theta times d theta. Try using the trig identity to simplify 1 plus tangent squared and then evaluate the integral. We can rewrite 1 plus tangent squared as secant squared, and that secant squared is going to cancel with the secant squared we have in the numerator. We're left with just the integral of d theta, which is equal to theta plus a constant. If you rewrite theta in terms of x, the original variable, you'll get the answer.
Here you'll discover yet another method for evaluating certain integrals. The method is called integration by parts, and it's based on the product rule for derivatives. Suppose you have two functions, f and g. Do you remember what the derivative of their product is?
We derived the product rule in a previous tutorial, but it's probably worth memorizing. The derivative of f times g is equal to f times the derivative of g plus f prime times g.
Right. The derivative of f times g equals f times the derivative of g plus the derivative of f times g. Next, let's integrate both sides of the product rule. On the left side here, we're taking the integral of a derivative. Can you simplify this expression, perhaps using the fundamental theorem of calculus? Don't worry about including a constant of integration for this one.
We know from before that the integral of a derivative is just the function itself. So this entire expression is just equal to f times g.
Exactly. The integral of a derivative gives you the function inside the integral. So this expression on the left simplifies to f times g. Now let's just subtract this integral over here from both sides. And let's swap the two sides of this equation. When you see an integral like this one on the left and turn it into an expression like the one on the right, this is called integrating by parts. So great, this is called integration by parts. But let's see how to use it. Suppose you want to find the integral of x times the cosine of x. In this equation up top, let's set the function f equal to x, and let's set the derivative of g equal to cosine x. Try using this equation to help you find an equivalent expression for this integral.
We've set f to be equal to x, and g prime to be equal to cosine of x. This equation tells us that we need two more things, f prime and g. We can get f prime from f. That's just one. And we can get g from g prime. That's equal to the sine of x. Plug these into this formula here.
Good work! After setting f equal to x and g prime equal to cosine x, you found that f prime equals 1 and g equals sine x, since the derivative of sine is cosine. Once you had expressions for f prime and g, you were able to plug these into the expression at the top. F times g becomes x times sine x, and the f prime times g inside this integral becomes 1 times sine x. 1 times sine x is still sine x. Can you evaluate this integral? Again, don't worry about the integration constant.
We want to find what minus the integral of sine x dx is. Well, an antiderivative of sine x is negative cosine x. And we had this minus sign from before. They cancel out and give us cosine of x.
Here we have a negative integral of sine x, and that equals a positive cosine x. So, great. Using integration by parts, you found that the integral of x cosine x equals x sine x plus cosine x. But what would have happened if you had switched which of these two functions here was f and which was g prime? Let's now set f equal to cosine x and g prime equal to x. Try using integration by parts again, but now with this reassignment of f and g prime.
The two missing parts again are f prime and g. F prime is the derivative of f, which here is negative sine of x. G is the antiderivative of g prime, which is 1 half x squared. Now we can plug these into this formula.
Okay, let's review what you did. With f now equal to cosine x and g prime equal to x, f prime equals minus sine x and g equals 1 half x squared. And so integration by parts gave you this expression. Yikes! If you thought finding the integral of x cosine x was tough, try finding the integral of 1 half x squared sine x. It's even tougher. In general, you can try using integration by parts when you have an integral where two functions are being multiplied together. But you'll have to think carefully about which function you call f and which you call g prime. Setting f equal to x here was a good idea because the integral on the right side has an f prime in it. The derivative of x is 1, and having that 1 in this integral on the right side made it a little simpler to evaluate. The strategy for picking which function is f in integration by parts is that taking the derivative of f should result in a simpler function. For example, f is usually a good choice for polynomials because derivatives decrease the powers of polynomials, and it's often less work to integrate a function with a lower power. So make sure that f prime is simpler to integrate than f, and also make sure that g isn't any tougher to integrate than g prime. In this example, integrating sine was no tougher than integrating cosine, so the cosine was a good candidate for g prime. Let's look at another integral, x times e to the x. What's a good choice for f and g prime inside this integral?
If we pick x to be f, then f prime is much simpler. F prime is just 1. If we choose f to be x, then this has to be g prime. And that's good for us, because the antiderivative of e to the x is just e to the x, so it's no worse. So it looks like this is a good choice.
Exactly. You should set f equal to x once again, because its derivative is 1. And setting g prime equal to e to the x means that g also equals e to the x, since the derivative of e to the x is e to the x. Great. But so far, we've only been looking at indefinite integrals. Let's switch over to definite integrals. Here's what we got when we integrated both sides of the product rule. But now let's make all of these definite integrals between a and b. Try using the fundamental theorem of calculus to once again simplify the left side of this equation.
Again, the fundamental theorem of calculus tells us that the integral of this derivative is just this function inside. That's f of x times g of x. So now we have to evaluate this between b and a. That's going to give us f of b times g of b minus f of a times g of a.
Yes, to evaluate a definite integral, you need the antiderivative of this function inside the integral. And the antiderivative of this expression cancels out this derivative here, leaving us with f times g. F and g are both functions of x, so we can also write this expression as f of x times g of x. And this definite integral is equal to this antiderivative evaluated at the upper limit of integration, which is b, and we subtract from that the antiderivative evaluated at the lower limit, which is a. So we have f times g at x equals b minus f times g at x equals a. There's a more convenient way to write an expression like this. We can write the function we're looking at, which is f of x times g of x. Next, we'll put this inside some square brackets. Then we'll put a b up here and an a down here. This notation means this. It means look at the function inside the square brackets, evaluate it at the number up here, and then subtract the function evaluated at the number down here. Okay, so great. We have a simplified expression for this integral on the left. Now let's just move things around a little bit. We'll subtract this integral from both sides. And let's just flip the two sides of this equation. So here's an expression for integration by parts when you're working with definite integrals. One last problem. Use integration by parts to evaluate this expression, the integral of x times e to the x from 1 to 2. In this tutorial, we'll explore partial fractions, which can help you evaluate integrals for certain kinds of functions. Let's start with this function, 1 over x squared plus 3x plus 2. What techniques, if any, can you use to evaluate the integral of this function?
Let's look at these choices individually. Integration by parts is something that works when you're trying to integrate a function that looks like the product of two other functions. It'll have the form u of x times v of x. But that's not the case here, so integration by parts isn't going to work for this function. U substitution works for functions that look like they were made with a chain rule. A function like 2x times e to the x squared works because 2x just happens to be the derivative of the inner function x squared, and we're multiplying these two things together. But do we have that here? No. Trig substitution works when you have something that looks like 1 plus or minus x squared in the function. But we don't have that here either. And finally, exponential substitution is something we haven't even talked about. Who knows what that is? So the truth is, none of these are good strategies.
Exactly. None of those strategies you've seen so far can help you with this integral. So let's try something else instead. First, what's an equivalent way to write this fraction? Nicely done. Yes, 1 over x squared plus 3x plus 2 equals 1 over x plus 1 minus 1 over x plus 2. Fractions whose denominators have a lower power or degree, but which add up to a fraction with a higher degree in the denominator, are called partial fractions. This expression is equal to the one on the left, but this one is easier to integrate because the denominators are linear. There are no squares or cubic powers of x here. The highest power of x is 1. So now that we've rewritten the original fraction using partial fractions, evaluate this integral. Two integrals. The integral of 1 over x plus 1 is the natural log of x plus 1, and the integral of 1 over x plus 2 is the natural log of x plus 2. Since this was an indefinite integral, you could also have added a constant here. An equivalent way to write this solution comes from using the log identity for subtraction. The log of one expression minus the log of another expression is equal to the log of that first expression divided by the second expression. So the integral of 1 over x squared plus 3x plus 2 equals the natural log of x plus 1 over x plus 2. And you found that by splitting up this original fraction into partial fractions. Let's try another example. Suppose you wanted to use partial fractions to find the integral of 4x minus 7 over x squared minus 3x plus 2. What do you think the denominators of the partial fractions would be? Good choice. When using partial fractions, you'll want to factor the denominator into linear functions. X squared minus 3x plus 2 equals x minus 1 times x minus 2. So let's make these the denominators of our partial fractions. The fraction inside the integral is 4x minus 7 over x squared minus 3x plus 2. And we want to rewrite this fraction as something over x minus 1 plus something over x minus 2. Well, let's call those numerators a and b. We want to find a and b such that this equation is always true for every value of x. In other words, we want to find the values of a and b so that this expression is equivalent to our fraction over here. To help us find a and b, how can you rewrite the right side of this equation? Nicely done. Yes, a over x minus 1 plus b over x minus 2 equals a times x minus 2 plus b times x minus 1 all over x squared minus 3x plus 2. To find a and b, we can first cancel out these denominators, leaving us with 4x minus 7 equals a times x minus 2 plus b times x minus 1. Now we said this equation has to be true for any value of x. Try solving for a by plugging in a clever value for x. Hint: don't bother distributing the a and b into these expressions. Great work! Let's quickly review what you did. First, you cleverly plugged in 1 for x. So over here you have 1 minus 1, which is 0, and b times 0 is still 0. So by setting x equal to 1, you got rid of the b and made this an equation with just an a in it. 4 times 1 is still 4, and 4 minus 7 is minus 3. 1 minus 2 is minus 1, so the right side of this equation becomes minus a. Dividing both sides by minus 1 gives us 3 equals a, or a equals 3. So that was a. Now try using a similar method to find b. Right, this time you plugged in 2 for x to get rid of the a in this equation, and you found that b equals 1. Great, so let's plug these values of a and b into our equation with the partial fractions. And so the integral of our original fraction is equal to the integral of these partial fractions. Evaluate this indefinite integral. Exactly. The integral of this first partial fraction is 3 times the natural log of x minus 1, and the integral of the second partial fraction is the natural log of x minus 2. And for indefinite integrals, which are the same thing as antiderivatives, you can add a constant as well. So let's review the steps for using partial fractions. First, you want to break up the denominator into linear terms, which look like this one here, 3x plus 4. Linear expressions are a number times x plus or minus another number. Then you want to set the fraction inside the integral equal to the sum of a few constants, call them a, b, c, and so on, over those linear terms. You can solve for the constants by choosing clever values of x or by solving linear equations. And finally, integrate the partial fractions. As a final challenge, try finding the integral of 5x over x squared plus x minus 6.